The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. In our world, nothing is lost. The droppings of birds fertilize the ground. The ground sends up grass. The grass nourishes the sheep. Evil lives on as well. A bit of gossip becomes a rumor. The rumor grows into a falsehood. The falsehood engenders fear, and the fear leads to a killing. A malicious word wounds a soul. An act of indifference congeals a heart. For good or for evil, nothing is lost.
I had nothing to do with it. Nothing at all. Fate. Simply fate. Or if that answer doesn't satisfy you, call it the machinations of some spirit, some minor deity bent on mischief. A spirit whose name I don't know. If such a spirit chose to work through me, and that's possible, I suppose, it was without my knowledge or my will. I swear to you, that's true.
Our mystery drama, Nobody Dies, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Elspeth Eric and stars Terry Keane and Anne Shepherd. It is sponsored in part by True Value Hardware Stores and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. The story has its beginning 50 years ago. It's a beautiful spring day. A young woman stands at the door of a large colonial house, dignified and serene and surrounded by great stretches of clipped lawn, spotted here and there by beds of bright flowers. There is something tentative in the manner of the young woman, something timid as she raises her hand to touch the button by the door.
I'm thinking to myself, what am I doing here? The advertisement in the local paper, it said, housekeeper wanted, live in, private quarters, apply between 9 and 10 a.m. It had given the address and the name Holt, and that was all. I knew this was a very fancy section of our town, and the minute I saw the big white house with the green shutters, my knees started to shake. Would anyone trust me with the care of such a house? But I pushed the button and said a little prayer. I was desperate. I needed this job more than anything in the world.
Yes?
There she stood, the woman who had to be Mrs. Holt, who held my future in her hands. She was about my own age. She was tall, blonde, and serene. And she was very, very pregnant.
You've come about the position.
The job, yes.
Well, come on in.
Oh, thank you very much.
Shall we go into the living room?
Yes, thank you.
Sit down, any place. You look rather young. How old are you?
29.
Ah. Well, tell me about yourself. Or would you rather I told you about the position first?
That would be fine.
Right. This house has 10 rooms. 5 bedrooms.
Mm-hmm.
2 of them are in the back of the house, and they have their own bath. Those will be reserved for whoever takes the position.
Oh, that sounds very nice.
And there's a cook. Cleaning woman comes in 3 times a week. It's a question of making beds and doing some dusting, answering the door, doing the shopping, things like that, and supervising the cook and the cleaning lady.
It doesn't sound very hard.
Well, it's what I used to do myself till I got pregnant.
When are you going to have your baby?
Any minute now, can't you tell? Now, tell me about yourself. Don't think I mind your being young. I'd like to have someone my own age around the house.
Well, I used to have a house. I mean, not a house like this, just a little house. But I did all the work, and I think I kept it nice. Clean and nice, you know, and attractive.
I'm sure you did. But you have a house now.
I couldn't afford it after my husband left me.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Since he left me, I've been living in a furnished room, and I've been doing house cleaning by the day. I'm very good at it. But it's not like living in a real house. I mean, having something to count on.
Oh, of course it isn't.
Especially when you have a little boy to think of.
A little boy? You have a little boy?
Mm-hmm. 2 years old.
Well, how do you manage? Working all day in other people's homes.
Well, I take him with me. He has his toys and his coloring books, and he's never any trouble, really. He never cries, and he's never been sick, never. I mean, not even a cold.
All right. All right, I understand.
But if we could be in the same house all the time...
I understand. I really do. What would you want in the way of salary?
Oh, anything. Whatever you want to pay.
Well, I'll be as generous as I possibly can. What's your little boy's name?
Jamie. His name is Jamie. That was the beginning of the most beautiful part of my whole life. Mrs. Holt's baby was born about 3 weeks later, a little girl. And she was named Verity. Isn't that a beautiful name, Verity? It means truth or reality. I looked it up. It took me a while to get up the nerve to ask her where Mr. Holt was, the baby's father. And when she told me he died right soon after she got pregnant, I cried. Besides running the house, I helped take care of the baby, the little girl, Verity. And you don't have to believe this if you don't want to, but Jamie was never one bit jealous of Verity. Children are, you know. And very often they're jealous of new babies, and you have to be careful. But even Mrs. Holt noticed how Jamie loved the baby.
Alice, you'll never believe this.
What won't I believe?
I was in the nursery this morning, and Jamie was standing by the baby's crib, and you know what I heard him say. I love you, Verity, a bustle and a peck and a hug around the neck. Really, I heard him. That's what he said.
Well, that's what I used to say to him when he was a baby. I still say it.
Ah, oh, you're a wonderful mother, Alice.
Life just went on that way, and I was as happy as it was possible to be.
Alice, look at this.
What? Why, it's a drawing.
In pastels.
Of a little bird on a branch.
Oh, it's very good, don't you think?
It's very touching. Very sweet.
Jamie gave it to me.
Jamie?
He made it in school.
But he's only 8 years old.
No. I'm going to frame it, and I'm going to hang it on the wall.
That's the way it went. Every day better than the one before. And nothing but nice things to look forward to.
Where did Jamie learn so much poetry, Alice?
Well, I suppose he learned it in school.
I heard him the other day. He and Verity were out here in the garden, and I could hear them through the window, loud and clear. Stay, O sweet, and do not rise. The light that shines comes from thine eyes. The day breaks not. It is my heart, because that you and I must part. Stay, or else my joys will die and perish in their infancy.
Well, for heaven's sake.
I happen to know that's John Donne. From the 16th century, and why a boy of 14 would bother to learn it, I can't imagine.
Jamie went on learning poetry. I never asked him about it, why he bothered. I thought it was nice that he did. One day I heard his voice in the conservatory. I stopped to listen, and then I realized he wasn't alone.
For thy sweet love remembered such wealth brings, that then I scorned to change my state with kings.
Oh, Jamie. That's beautiful.
That's Shakespeare.
Jamie was just 16. I didn't know a line of Shakespeare, and I'd never known that he did. I couldn't help asking him about it.
I know all of Shakespeare's sonnets by heart.
Oh, my goodness, I am impressed.
I hope Verity was impressed. I was trying to tell her how much I love her.
Love? You told her you loved her?
I've always loved her. She knows that.
You're both very young.
Romeo and Juliet were even younger, Mom.
Well, life went on. Jamie got into the local college right in the same town. Lucky for us because he could go on living at home. He'd finished his second year and Verity was enrolled to start that fall.
Mom, I'm going to ask Verity to marry me.
Jamie!
No, I don't mean right away. I mean when she's finished college. But by then I'll be making a living and...
You're sure about that?
Oh, of course I'm sure.
Darling, there's no need to rush into anything, you
I'm
know?
I'm not rushing. I'm just asking
but
her.
But you'll meet other girls?
Mom, I've loved Verity all my life. Don't you know that?
He asked her to marry him?
Well, of course, he didn't mean right away. After she finishes college, I mean, he wouldn't expect her to marry him now.
That's very considerate of him.
Mrs. Holt, I don't think we have to take it seriously. They'll both meet other people. Jamie says that won't make any difference, but you never can tell, can you?
I think I'll send Verity away to college. Some good Eastern school.
Oh, would you do that? They're both so happy here.
Alice, how much did you have to do with this?
With what, Mrs. Holt?
With this attachment, this liaison between your son and my daughter.
Well, I didn't have anything to do with it.
You plotted, didn't you? From the beginning, you plotted and you schemed to make everything turn out this way?
No, I had no idea anything
First,
like this
First, you wormed your way into this house, bringing your son with you. Then you made yourself indispensable. You pretended to be my friend.
I did not pretend. None of this is true.
Are you some kind of witch? I think you are. And you've been weaving spells up there alone in your room.
No, Mrs. Holt,
Surely
no.
You know. You've always known that my daughter could never marry a son of yours. It's unthinkable.
Had nothing to do with it. Nothing at all. Or had I had everything to do with it? I don't know, and I have thought long and hard about it. I'm reduced to calling it fate. Simply fate. Or call it the machinations of some spirit. Some spirit perhaps lodged in me. A spirit whose name I don't know. If such a spirit chose to work through me, it was without my knowledge or my will. I swear that's true. I swear. I believe. I think it's true. Oh, I hope it's true.
Of course, there are spirits in all of us. Spirits full of energy and of huge power. Some drive the people they inhabit to great accomplishment. Then, of course, there are other spirits, equally potent. Spirits which move their possessors to cowardice, to morbidity, to self-destruction, even to the annihilation of those they love. I'll be back shortly with Act Two. When Alice became housekeeper to the affluent Mrs. Holt, it was a relief from a life of drudgery and anxiety, and a haven both for herself and for her son, Jamie, 2 years old. When her employer soon after gave birth to a daughter, it was only natural that Alice should retain her position in the household and that the two children should grow up together. However, at the close of Act One, we heard...
Alice... How much did you have to do with this?
With what, Mrs.
With this, Holt? with this attachment, this liaison between your son and my daughter.
I didn't have anything to do
you
with it.
You plotted, didn't you? You plotted and schemed and made everything turn out this way. Surely you know, you've always known that my daughter could never marry a son of yours. It's unthinkable.
My beautiful life in her beautiful house had come to an end. Our friendship had ended too. If indeed it had ever been the friendship I'd thought it to be. For the first time, she had reminded me that I was her servant, and my son was the son of a servant, and that the marriage of her daughter to the son of one such as myself was, what was the word? Unthinkable. I started to pack our clothes, Jamie's and mine.
Is that you, Jamie?
It's Mrs. Holt, Alice.
Oh, just a minute.
I want to talk to you, Alice.
Well, all right, come in.
Thank you. You've been packing?
You don't want us here anymore.
Oh, Alice, I didn't mean anything like that.
You are afraid Verity might want to marry Jamie and he's not good enough for her.
But as you said, Alice, they're both very young. They'll meet other people. Now that I've had a little time to think about it, I realize how right you are. It was just a kind of shock when you first told me. Verity isn't old enough to marry anyone.
You said I planned it for them to fall in love and get married.
That was a ridiculous thing for me to say. Please forgive me. We've been together so long. Won't you forgive me? Please.
I suppose the idea was kind of a shock to you.
It was. Or I couldn't have said those things.
Well, if you really didn't mean them...
I didn't.
Then I guess it's all right.
Oh, Alice. Thank you. You'll never regret it. And you will stay on here, won't you?
I've always loved it here, Mrs. Holt. And so is Jamie.
Then it's settled. You'll stay on, and so will Jamie.
But she sent Verity away to a college in the East. Mrs. Holt had said she would do it, and she did. Verity and Jamie wrote to each other almost every day. I think he wrote every day. His ways grew quieter, more reserved, but he'd always been like that, more or less, and I didn't worry about him. Not until Verity came home for her vacation.
Verity's engaged to some guy.
Some guy?
Well, some guy she met in the East.
Oh, Jamie.
What's the matter?
Well, you mean you don't care?
Well, why should I care? She won't marry him.
Well, how can you be so sure?
Verity belongs to me. She always has, ever since she was born.
Jamie's confidence frightened me. I thought back to when Mrs. Holt had called me some kind of a witch. I didn't want to hear those words again from her lips. Besides, Jamie could be right. Maybe Verity wouldn't marry the man she met in the East. Maybe in some way I didn't comprehend she belonged to my son. But then a year later, it happened.
We'll have the wedding right here in the house, I think. Or would it be better in a church?
I think a church wedding would be the nicest.
You're probably right. His parents will be here. They'll expect it. His father's in the diplomatic service. Did I tell you?
No, you didn't tell me.
Yes, I think we'll have the wedding in the church.
I think that's best.
Alice... Of course, Verity will want Jamie to be there. But he needn't attend if he doesn't want to. We'll all understand.
It wasn't their understanding I cared about. It was Jamie's. He had to understand that he'd aspired to something too far above him. That he would never have the girl he'd loved from the day she was born. He had to understand and go on living as best he could till some other girl could fill the void in his life.
I'll be there. Why not?
Jamie, if it's too painful...
It will be painful, but that's all right.
I'm so glad you're taking it this way.
What way am I taking it?
Well, realistically, facing up to it.
Didn't you tell me that's what verity means? Reality, the truth?
Yes, I did tell you that.
Well, then, besides, verity still belongs to me. No matter what she does with her life or I do with mine, verity still belongs to me, and she always will. That's reality, and that's truth.
His words echoed in my mind all during the ceremony. Just as he'd said he'd be, Jamie was in the church, standing up way in the back, his eyes never leaving the handsome young couple at the altar. The young married couple took off on their honeymoon. Jamie went on to finish college, and Mrs. Holt and I went on in the big house. Not quite the friends we once had been, but on good terms. And one day...
Another letter from Verity. It's from London.
What does she have to say?
Oh, lots of things. Dear Mummy, we're settled here in the dearest flat you've ever seen. It's in Chelsea, a very old part of London, but fashionable in an arty sort of way.
We go to the theater all the time. The theater is so wonderful here and not too expensive. I mean, compared with other things. And we go to parties, mostly with other couples living the same kind of life we do. Diplomatic service life, I mean. We've made some dear friends.
And here... She goes on about their friends, Bibsy and Punko and Tupper and Jinky. I can't make out all the names. Now, here's one here that looks like... Did somebody come in?
I think it's Jamie.
Jamie, that you?
I was just going upstairs.
I've got a letter from Verity.
Oh?
And I was just reading it to your mother. You want to hear it?
Well, I was just going upstairs.
But I'm almost finished. Here, let's see, where was I? All about, yes. I've saved the best news for the last, Mummy. I'm going to have a baby. Oh!
A baby? Verity's going to have a baby?
Oh, why didn't she send me a cable or call up?
When is she going to have
it? She says, wait, not for 8 months, but she couldn't resist telling... Oh, I wonder if I should go over there. Or if she'll want to come here. Oh, dear me, there's so much to think about. My first grandchild. Imagine.
Jamie? Where did Jamie go?
Alice, I'm going to go down to the cable office and tell her to phone me collect tonight. I'll be back right away.
Jamie?
And,
are you upstairs?
I'll give her your love, Alice.
Jamie? Where are you? Jamie? Jamie? Are you all right? Jamie! Oh, no, dear Lord, don't let it be. Don't let it... Oh, my... Jamie, what have you done?
I missed...
Oh, you're bleeding.
I missed twice.
Your head is bleeding.
It's not so easy to kill yourself.
No, I'll get the doctor.
No, don't leave me. Stay with me.
Jamie, I have to call a doctor. Please, let go of my arm.
I want you to stay with me, Mom.
Please, Janie, let me.
I'll be all right. I want you with me, Mom. It's always been you and me. You've always been with me. You've never gone off and left me. Don't go off and leave me now.
Please, you've got to let me call the doctor. Please.
I won't die. Nobody dies, Mom.
Jamie, please.
And I want you to tell that to Verity, Mom. Would you do that? Tell her nobody really dies. Everybody goes on and on.
Please, please.
Good old Mom, you're really the best. Oh, always there when I needed you. Always right nearby. Always where you could see me and hear me. Remember, Mom, all my life, from way back. Be near me now, Mom. Listen to me now.
Yes. Yes, all right.
Did you understand what I told you about what to tell Verity?
You mean Nobody dies.
That's right. Tell her that. She'll understand. Just say, nobody dies.
The blood was still running from his poor head, and he was still staring at me. But the hand that had been gripping my arm went limp. And I knew he was dead. The light had gone out of his eyes. The light had gone out of his life. My son was dead. My son was dead. I tried to take that in, even as his last words echoed through my mind. Nobody dies. Nobody dies.
The beginning of mourning is the acceptance of the fact of death. We twist and turn to evade the reality. We make up fantasies to deny it. We comfort ourselves with memories which hurt while they comfort. There simply is no way to escape the awful pain. Unless perhaps we can bring ourselves to believe what appears to be a flagrant lie. Unless we can believe that nobody dies. I'll return shortly with Act Three. Toward the end of the act just completed, Alice's son Jamie shot himself after hearing the news that the girl he had loved all his life, who had married another man, was now preparing to give birth to that man's child. Holding fast to his mother's hand, Jamie had spoken his last words.
Tell her that, Mom. Verity'll understand. Tell her nobody dies.
Mrs. Holt, of course, was dreadfully shocked when she came home and I had to tell her what had happened. We never discussed it or referred to it in any way. But I'm certain she knew as well as I that the fact of Verity's being pregnant crushed Jamie's last hope that one day she might return to him. At any rate, Mrs. Holt persuaded her daughter to come back to her mother's house to have her child.
Oh, Alice, it's so marvelous being here. You know, I really didn't know I'd need my mother so much. But the first time, you know how it is. It's all so new, so important.
Your husband couldn't come with you?
No, not right now. They can't spare him in London. Maybe later.
Verity, I have something I want to give to you, if you don't mind.
How could I possibly mind?
Well, I don't want to make you sad, but, these are some of Jamie's baby clothes.
Oh, Alice.
Now, they may be old-fashioned by now. I don't know what babies wear these days.
Not very much.
But they are all made by hand, and you don't see much of that anymore.
Oh, they're lovely. You know, Jamie was my dearest friend. For years and years, more than a friend, more like a brother.
He loved you.
I know he did.
The last words he spoke before he died, they were for you.
For me, really?
He said, nobody dies, Mom. Tell Verity that. She'll understand. Nobody dies. That was the last thing he ever said. A couple of seconds later, he was dead.
Alice.
Verity, do you know what he meant?
Well, no, not exactly.
He said that you would know. He was very definite about that.
Well, perhaps he meant that as long as a person is remembered by the people who loved him, that he isn't really dead.
You think that's what he meant?
I can't think of anything else.
Verity had her baby, a darling little boy named John after his father. And a few months later, Verity went back to London, but she phoned once a week at least, and the letters flew thick and fast across the ocean. Sometimes Verity would write to me about the baby, nice chatty notes full of all sorts of details. Then one day, I got a present in the mail. Well, imagine all the way from London. Imagine Verity thinking of me. That's really wonderful of her.
What is it?
Well, it's a drawing.
Well, so it is.
A drawing of a bird sitting on the branch of a tree.
So it is.
She says it's little John's first drawing, and she wants me to have it.
Done in pastels.
Yes. It's very good, don't you think?
Alice, how old was Jamie when he did the picture of the bird sitting on a branch?
I said I didn't remember, but I did. It was when Jamie was precisely the age that little John was when he painted his bird on a branch. One night the phone rang. It was London calling. Verity was on the other end, and Mrs. Holt told me to listen in on the upstairs extension.
Verity?
Mother?
How are you, darling?
I'm fine. How are you?
Fine, fine.
How's Alice?
She's on the extension. Alice, say hello.
I'm fine, Verity. How's the boy?
He's marvelous, simply marvelous, almost as tall as I am.
No.
You mean it?
And bright, you'd hardly believe it.
Of course I'd believe it. Why wouldn't I?
Well, I never was. Listen, he knows poetry, really.
That's remarkable.
He recited a whole poem to me today. Not a long poem.
Well, I should hope.
Something by John Donne.
John Donne?
16th century. Can you imagine something about, stay, O sweet, and do not rise. I forget.
The light that shines comes from your eyes.
Yes, that's it. Alice, is that you?
The day breaks not. It is my heart, because that you and I must part.
You know it. You really know it.
Stay, or else my joys will die and perish in their infancy.
That's it? Can you imagine a young boy knowing something like that?
Verity. Verity, my dear, we've talked long enough.
Oh, but I have all kinds of things to tell you yet.
Yes, it'll have to do for now. We're rather busy here.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll call you next week then. Bye. Bye, Alice.
Alice? Alice, will you come downstairs, please?
There was nothing I could say to Mrs. Holt. Of course, it was the same poem Jamie had learned and recited at exactly the same age. But Jamie had died a full year before this boy was born. This boy lived 3,000 miles away in a foreign country. Then came the fateful day. Verity arrived from London.
Darling, how wonderful you've come home.
Mother?
How are you, Verity? Welcome back.
Alice?
Darling, you don't look at all well.
Don't I?
Have you been ill?
No.
Did your husband come with you?
No. No, my son came with me.
Well, for heaven's sakes, where is he?
Oh, he'll be along presently. I wanted to see you alone first.
Well, I'll just go upstairs and see if anything...
Alice, please stay here. I want to talk to both of you.
All right.
Mother, this is going to come as a shock for you. My husband has left me.
Oh, darling.
Oh, Verity, I'm so sorry to hear that.
Well, perhaps it's not final.
It's final.
Well, whatever happened, I'm sure it wasn't your fault.
I don't know whose fault it was.
There are always two sides to every...
Maybe it was your fault, Alice.
Mine?
Or maybe it was the fault of your son.
What?
What could Jamie have to do with it?
I believe that he was some kind of sorcerer or a wizard of some kind, and you are a witch and a hag.
Charity, don't.
I believe the two of you conspired against me from the very start, from the day you entered this house.
What are you talking about?
You don't know. You really don't know.
I swear I don't know.
Stay where you are, both of you. I have something to show you. Johnny, can you come in here, please?
Mrs. Holt, what's happened?
Quiet, Alice.
Mother? Alice? This is my son, John.
Grandma, it's been so long. Now, how many years?
A good many years.
Well, you got a kiss for me?
Of course, John. Of course, my boy.
And you're Alice. Hello, Alice.
I could only stare, dumbstruck, at the handsome young man who stood before me, holding out his hand, a warm, friendly smile on his face. For that face, that smile, that voice, all were exact replicas of the face and the smile and the voice of my dead son. Young John, in the innocence of his youth and the ignorance, was the only one of the household who retained any self-possession. Verity moved about the house with a tight mouth and baleful look. Mrs. Holt kept to her room most of the time. When I took her something to eat, she told me that Verity and John would stay on with her. John was going to teach at the local high school, and Verity... Well, where could Verity go?
Verity's child was destined to be the precise image of Jamie. Why? I don't know. But I don't blame you.
Perhaps you should. I hoped for so many years that they would marry and have a child. Perhaps all my hoping, my wishing, my praying for something that never came to pass... But you mustn't think Jamie had anything to do with it.
Didn't he wish, hope, and pray?
Yes, but he loved her so. He'd never have wanted anything like this to happen to her.
I don't know. I cannot tell. But this I do know for a certainty. There are forces in the world over which we have no control. Alice, I think you best leave this house. Tonight, if possible.
I did leave that night and moved into a furnished room. I got work almost immediately, cleaning by day, just as I'd done before Jamie and I became part of Mrs. Holt's household. Every now and then, I would walk by the high school just to catch a glimpse of young John who was teaching there. It was a thrill. Strange, macabre, but still a thrill to see that straight young figure, that fresh young face, so exactly like that of my dead son. One day as school was letting out for the day, I summoned my courage and spoke to him. Mr. Holt?
Huh?
John?
Well, it's Alice, isn't it?
Yes, it's Alice.
Well, I've asked Mother about you. Why aren't you living with us anymore? You moved out so suddenly.
Well, with you and your mother there, you needed the room.
Oh, there's plenty of room. Now, come on, why don't you move back?
Oh, no, no. Really, I couldn't. Tell me, what are you teaching? What subject?
English literature. What I've always wanted to teach.
Oh, that's nice.
With special emphasis on the greatest writer of them all.
You mean...
Shakespeare, of course.
You like Shakespeare?
I worship him. I always have. I knew all of Shakespeare's sonnets, all of them, by the time I was 16.
I stayed away from the school after that. I was afraid of what might happen. Not a tangible fear, you understand, for I had no idea what there was to be afraid of. Only I think that I might indeed be a witch, a sorceress. But then came a day when it was imperative that I see not John, but his mother, Verity.
What was it you wanted to tell me, Alice? You said it was important.
It is. Tomorrow is John's birthday.
I know that. Did you think I'd forget my own son's birthday?
No, of course I didn't think that. But you might not remember. After tomorrow, John will be of the same age as Jamie was. When Jamie...
When he died? Is that what you mean?
When he killed himself.
Killed himself? Alice, no one ever told me that. Mother said it was an accident.
Verity, he shot himself twice when he heard that you were going to have a child.
Oh, Alice, I should have been told this.
What could you have done? Nothing.
Alice, I must tell you something. If there was any sorcery or any witchcraft, it was wrought by me. Every day of the 9 months I carried John within me, I wished with all my heart and all my soul that I could be carrying Jamie's child.
A whole year has passed. Nothing untoward has happened to John. I believe him to be safe. I still live in a furnished room and go out to work by the day. But on Thanksgiving and Christmas and sometimes on other holidays, I go to the big white house and spend a pleasant day. And when I hear John's voice, his laughter, when I look at his handsome face, his friendly smile, so often directed at me, then I think to myself, it's true, quite true, what Jamie said to me at the last. Nobody dies. Not really. Nobody really dies.
Our drama appears to end on a placid note. Four people gathered round a festive table. If you walked in on them today, you would never guess that behind their light talk, their pleasant smile, their solicitude for one another, their consideration and their kindnesses, lies a deep and mysterious tragedy which no one of them comprehends. I'll be back shortly. There is a moral to be gleaned from our story, and I do not think there is, and certainly there was never meant to be. It is the old one. Be careful what you wish for. You might get it. But if you take my advice, you will not look for a moral. You will simply accept the whole thing for what it is, and no more. A story. Our cast included Terry Keane, Ann Shepherd, Jack Grimes, and Morgan Fairchild. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
Is he all right, Doctor?
The operation appears to have been successful. He's in the special recovery room we set up for him. But he isn't conscious, of course. Won't be for a good long while.
Can we see him?
Not just yet, I'm afraid. Later on. Maybe toward evening. We don't want to complicate things.
Dr. Peters.
Yes?
I haven't mentioned this to Jane, but I imagine she's been wondering, too. When he's better and, you know, when he can talk about everything, which one is he going to be?
This is the first operation of its kind, you understand. We're all waiting to see what will happen.
Yes, but... But who will he be?
I can't really say.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and True Value Hardware Stores. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.